Thanks. Well, hey, everybody. It's really smoky up here. I'm already high as a kite. Well, geez, I gotta make sure I'm sort of, I gotta get one of these at home, you know, make sure it's not sticking up in the middle. So, great day so far. Thank you so much to the folks at Reactor. I know I've certainly been learning a lot, and I think there's been a lot of great conversation about how do we understand what our customers really want. You know, what is the job that they are hiring our product and services to do? It may not be sort of what that list of features is, but what is it they really want to accomplish? And how can we deliver that with a sense of delight and magic? Those are words we've been using a lot. And frankly, these are words that the design community often co-opts the language of delight and magic, but unfortunately often without delivering the same level of wonder. And I think that, you know, one of the things we heard from Karen was, wow, there's actually a recipe to deliver that wonder. And the result is building something cool. In a real way, you know, I think that we're seeing that wonder in lots of new iterations, especially with this new wave of technology that we've been seeing the last few years, with mobile. I mean, we're really, in a very real way, hurtling into this era of science fiction in our everyday life. And for me, at least, that's something that started, you know, very clearly in 2007 when Steve Jobs introduced this thing, the iPhone, right? And then we saw all the devices that came after it, this sort of new way of thinking about what these truly personal devices could do for us. It was really the first time in my adult life that I felt like my childhood vision of the future had actually come to pass. I mean, here was this little computer that can do so many things, little feats of magic that literally surprised me or made me laugh out loud or smile. And I think that's something that Karen mentioned in her talk, which was that, you know, mobile sort of suddenly supercharged all of these elements that bring us genuine joy. And it changed software. The web had already sort of begun this process, but mobile really brought it home. Software used to be this gray thing that we used to have to use to do all the dreary things in our life. And suddenly, this device made software fun, personality. The apps that you have on your phone say almost as much about you as the things you carry in your bag or the little bobbleheads that you put on your desk, right? So there are lots of opportunities and things to do with mobile. And I think that's probably something that consumes a lot of us right now. How do we do things on the small screen? How can we use the sensors that are on here? But what's been interesting me lately, and what's been keeping me up at night, frankly, is what's coming next? What is it that mobile unlocks in computing that lets us do new things? And what does that sort of point to for what's the next generation of technology? How do we prepare now for our work for what's coming next? So we're here to talk about what's possible now and how do we do that work now, what process should we use now. And I wanted to frame that by looking just a little bit ahead into the future. And I'm going to show you some really cool things, to use Karen's phrase. And I encourage you actually to think about her framework and think about, wow, what are these things that I'm showing you? How do those fit? Because I think you'll find that it maps pretty nicely. So if you're ready, friends, I propose an expedition to the hazy edges of the technology universe to find these sort of hints of new technology and new kinds of interaction so that we can understand how to prepare for it in our work now and today. You with me? Yeah? All right. Let's go. But before we go too far, I want to start with where we are right now. What is it that mobile technology has unlocked to change the nature of computing and to make it so deeply personal? We've been talking about personal computers since the days of disco, right? I mean, that we're going to have these personal computers, but in a very real way, these things are the first truly personal computer, in part because it's always with us, but even more important is we have these sensors, packed with sensors, right? It's the sensors that give these devices superpowers, and that means they give us superpowers. I mean, think about what these things can do. They're packed with all these capabilities, GPS, camera, microphone, touch, a light detector, proximity detector, accelerometer, a compass, a gyroscope, for crying out loud, you know? And if you think about it, what these sensors are able to do, this awareness and interaction with the world around us, it's those things that enable and supercharge all of those elements that Karen was telling us about just after lunch. that really sort of bring home this idea of accomplishment and connection and identity, sensation especially, you know, that direct action, that delta between sort of hassle and getting things done directly, countering that hassle. Every one of those elements that she mentioned is something that these new devices are exceptional at doing, and they've changed, I would argue, the nature of community of computing. Use these sensors. Think about designing for the sensors in addition to the screen. It's going to be a big theme throughout here for the next few minutes that I'm talking with you. Mobile is often considered the light version, the companion to the real computing experience. And so oddly, a lot of people start off the project saying, how can we do less in mobile compared to the real experience? And I would say that is the wrong question, because we can do more. These things can do so much more than the traditional computer. Often, though, when we sort of think about using these sensors, we start, and it's been useful, we're thinking about sort of broadly what's around us, using GPS, right? Where can I get a cup of coffee? When is the next train leaving from the station closest to me? That's useful. But I would encourage you to think not just what's around me, but often what's directly in front of me. And that really gets to that sensation piece that Karen was talking about. Because it has the opportunity not just to interpret reality, but to transform it, or to give us that sensation, right? I mean, that's this whole idea of augmented reality. I should say that a lot of times, augmented reality is a solution in search of a problem, right? It's sort of something that seems sort of cool, but then when you use it, it doesn't actually seem to have any practical use. It feels like a gimmick, and that's no good, right? That's not solving a real problem. That's scratching our own itch as technologists who just want to make something with the latest thing. But I would say that there are some uses of augmented reality that we're seeing that are actually really compelling and useful. And one of them I would just sort of start off with, and I would say it is useful, is entertainment and games. Here's an app called Skinvaders, which uses the front-facing camera on your phone or tablet to change your face into a game board where aliens are invading your skin. All right, let's take a look. So what's happening here, right, is that she's going to scan her face. And so now it knows where she is. And now aliens are planting eggs into her face. She's winning here, but she still wound up with an alien in her brain, right? So here's this idea of this game is being overlaid onto the experience around it and changing, again, this sort of this sensation, the impression of in the world around me. Kids love this thing, right? Now, this is sort of an interesting idea because what it's doing is overlaying, in this case, entertainment with a sense of whimsy onto the world around us. Part of the promise that we've always been told with this thing with augmented reality, though, is that we're also going to get information. I would say that that can be done with sort of some playfulness as well. But let's start off with just what happens when you can overlay information on top of this. It's an app called WordLens. And what it does is it takes augmented reality and uses computer vision to sort of, you know, you point your camera at text in one language, and then in real time, no internet connection required, it changes that text into the other language. So you're not going to order the tongue or the tripe by accident again, right? And hopefully it will even save you from some embarrassing situations. This is not particularly new technology, right? This is just camera vision, optical character recognition, recognizing the stuff and just saying, here's what that word is with a quick dictionary lookup. The magic is that it's actually using the same font and color and doing it in real time. So you have this idea of like, wow, this is this lens. But crucially, and the job that we're hiring it to do, is just tell me what this word means with as little effort as possible. It's saving me input. That's what the sensors are doing here, right? Camera vision saving me input so I don't have to type it into Google Translate. It's just doing it live. It's that direct-to-action idea that Karen was talking about, countering that hassle factor. So we can use these things to sort of gather and impose meaning on the world around us. But again, I don't think we should lose that element of play either. I think we can be both informational and kind of joyful. That's what IKEA is trying to do here. If the idea of games is to introduce whimsical what-if objects into the environment, IKEA doubles down on that to introduce whimsical what-if furniture. So the idea is that we scan something in the catalog, right? We sort of take a picture of it with our camera. We put the catalog down to say, I want the furniture to go here. And then boom, it just shows up in your living room. Right? So you can actually sort of get a sense of, looking through this little magic lens, where does this furniture wind up? And it allows not just sort of practical planning, but you know, you can actually play games here with your family, essentially, right? So there is this idea of play. The next best thing here, though, would be able to actually 3D print that furniture, right? So it's all, just beam it right in. We tend to think about augmented reality as a visual thing. But I want to show you something that you can sort of really expand that to use your sensors in a much more expansive way. This is an app called Table Drum that uses what the developers, right next door in Sweden, call augmented audio, using the microphone on the audio to do something special. I'll show you in a second. Table Drum is basically a drum pad app. Lots of these things in the app stores. You sort of tap out a rhythm on the screen, and it plays, you know, instrument sounds. And it can do that. But the really sort of special thing that it can do is listen to the sounds that you're making on the table around you and associate those with a drum sound. So what we're doing here is just tapping and playing like you normally would, and it's making a sound. But it doesn't know that glass sound yet, right? So we're going to teach it what the sound is when you hit the glass. We're going to choose a cymbal instrument, put it into training mode, and say, hey, app, listen to this. Got it? Okay. So now you're just playing again. Well, but it knows the sound now, right? So it's just it lets you do this thing again, direct to action, bridging that delta with natural gesture that I'm doing anyway, just sort of tapping on the table. And what's crucial about this is that while the logic is still in the computer, in the phone, the interaction is no longer on the screen. It's just the speaker. So this is really important. What sensors allow us to do, and what we're just about to see a huge explosion of, is moving the point of interaction off of the screen and into the environment around us. So we don't have to constantly be involved in this little piece of glass, but that we can have real connection with the people and with the environment around us using much more natural interactions, things that we would sort of normally do to do these things, that are just augmented by the computer itself. How cool is that? We can actually liberate ourselves from this, from being tethered to these devices. The devices can just listen and pay attention to what we're doing out in the rest of the world. So I've been really focused on these devices for the last several years, which means that I've been working a lot with touch. And touch screens, I think, are great. But what I've learned is that sometimes the best touch interfaces have no touch at all, because touch is clumsy. It's slow. You know, typing something in with autocorrect, it's always, there's something wrong, right? How can we use sensors to speed up that interaction, to get things immediately into my phone? And that's the idea that we're sort of starting to see, is using sensors to move the interaction and the information off of the screen and into the environment around us. Things get especially interesting, though, when you start adding custom sensors to these. You're seeing a lot of activity in this in the medical device community, which has always been great at making sensors for the body, but terrible at creating the interfaces and computing devices that go with them. And they've realized, hey, wait a second, almost everybody who is a customer now for us has a great computing device with a great interface. What if we just plug our sensors into that or make them talk to it? And so we're seeing some things like this, which is a little sensor, just the size of a push pin, right? That you can actually put into a pill, which turns it into a pill that can tell when it's being taken. So it's about the size of a grain of sand, and it's got the same stuff in it as you'd find in a vitamin, some copper, some magnesium. When you swallow it, it hits your stomach acid, just strong it just enough to turn it into a battery that can send a signal with a serial number on it. And people who are taking these wear these little patches with little Bluetooth on it, because it's just strong enough just to kind of get through your skin. And then this thing, this patch, relays the information to my phone, which adds GPS, timestamp, relays the information up to the internet for my doctor or my caretaker to review and say, oh, Josh is taking his medicine, good boy. Right? Wow. Couple of things here. Wow, you can track anything now, right? And also, something that's so disposable, something that you can just swallow, throw away. It's so trivially inexpensive now to put a sensor and an internet connection on anything that why wouldn't you? And what happens when you can do, make these just like small changes to things? You know, how does a pill become better when it's connected? Well, that's one example. What else can we do with medicine? I was talking to one device manufacturer, medical device manufacturer, that has come up with a sensor for people with really advanced pulmonary disease, sick hearts. And one of the early warning signs of this is a change in a few hours before a bad turn, a change in the blood pressure. And so they've created this sensor that you can embed in the body, surgically, in the artery near the heart, and it can detect this change in blood pressure, this subtle change. Trouble is, of course, it's in my body. How do I actually read the information? You touch a pad, and it downloads the information through your skin, into your phone, into a tablet, and then off to the internet. You guys, this started getting to be some kind of groovy Star Trek tricorder stuff here, right? It's pretty trippy. So as sensors become more advanced, there's more stuff that we can do. We can track anything. And it's so cheap. And the thing is, like, wow, if we can do that with these kinds of things, you know, what other sort of even whimsical things can we do? And there are some kind of Mickey Mouse ideas, literally. Here's one idea that came out of Walt Disney research. It's called the Botanicus Interacticus.
Botanicus Interacticus is a new interactive plant technology. It requires no plant instrumentation. A simple electrode placed in the soil turns any plant into an expressive, multi-touch, gesture-sensitive controller.
Oh yeah, plant UI, you know you've been waiting for it. Yep. Oh, that, yeah, that feels good. Yeah. Oh yeah, right there. Like, I have no idea why they made this thing. I don't know. The parks, the theme parks, I don't know why they did it. But what's interesting about it is, wow, they put a sensor on a plant and suddenly it's able to control the computer. Right? So that any sort of object in our real life, no matter how mundane, can somehow now become a controller, can be an interface to the machine. I don't even have to have anything to do with the screen. I don't even have to be near the computer. I can just, whatever, play with my plant. Why stop at plants when you can get to cows? Right? The Swiss, of course, have come up with a sensor that you can put into the cow and detects when the cow is in heat. And then the cow texts the farmer. Texting when you're in heat. I have a lot of friends who do that. And also, it's Switzerland, right? So that means that you can, that the text can be sent in three languages, you know, French, German, or Italian, because cow love, friends, knows no language boundary. And so now we've got the internet of cows. My point here, though, is not that it's like, oh, we're going to be using cows and plants to connect, to control our computers or to talk to our computers, but that we can use anything now. Because again, to say it again, it is so trivially inexpensive to put a sensor and an internet connection on anything, that anything that can be connected will be connected. Right? We've been focusing a lot on how can we make digital interfaces more physical. We've been etching them onto these little slabs that we take out into the world and communicating, detecting the physical world. But at the same time, what's also beginning to happen is that physical is beginning to have a digital presence, that a cow kind of lights up. We've been seeing this video with the tankers in the ferries, in the Baltic Sea. There's a digital presence to so much now, and that's only going to increase and grow, and frankly, become more personal, come into our personal space, sometimes, as we've seen, even into our bodies, which has obviously some privacy implications that are going to be interesting to sort out, but we have to because it's going to happen inevitably, because anything that can be connected will be connected. This is a big wind-up, right? I've promised to take you guys to the future, and we haven't even left home yet. But that's, you know, a really key part of what's transformed computing now is this ever presence of sensors that are so personal to the user. If we take a little hop, though, we sort of see another change that's happening, and that's mirroring. Your device is not only a sensor for input, but a broadcaster. So this is mirroring, right? And for the most part, that simply means screen sharing. It's the idea behind AirPlay, for example, in the Apple environment, where you can just mirror your screen via Apple TV to your television set to share photos, share videos. And that begins to make it social, not just with other people, but with other devices. I've got a smart device, my phone or my tablet, controlling a dumb device, my TV, right? Samsung and a lot of other manufacturers are taking another approach, which is to make TVs smart, stand alone, have their own interface. So you're seeing things like the Samsung Smart TV.
Smart Hub. See that? This TV actually recognizes my voice and pulls up the Samsung Smart Hub, giving me instant access to my favorite apps like ESPN Score Center.
I kind of hate that guy. You guys know what I'm talking about, right? I kind of hate that guy. And I'm not sure I'm crazy about his TV either, right? I mean, it seems kind of neat. It's got, wow, it's, you know, you can wave at it. Like, it's got a built-in Kinect, essentially. It's got its own operating system. I can talk to it. That seems fancy. But does it meet Karen's definition of cool? You know, I'm not sure. Because a lot of times these operating systems just aren't very good, right? But there's this whole idea that we need to make everything smart. For a long time, futurists, for some reason, really focus on the kitchen. All these appliances are going to be smart. The refrigerator, for some reason, is a huge fixation. We're going to have these smart refrigerators. Samsung, again, you know, it created the an internet refrigerator that syncs with Evernote. They released that in January. I mean, maybe. I mean, probably not, though. There's this idea that if we connect things, they have to have a screen and they have to be a web browser or a Twitter client. And I would suggest that's actually not the thing to do. We don't need screens everywhere. Ryan, at the beginning of the day, said, you know what? Think about what job people are hiring your product to do. What do you do to hire? What job do you want a microwave oven to do? I don't know about you guys, but the main job that I use for my microwave oven is to tell the time, right? It is a clock with an oven attached to it, right? How do you make that a better microwave oven by attaching it to the internet? How about making sure the clock is never wrong, right? When the power goes out, when the daylight saving ends, you know, make sure the clock is always right. That's one of the things we love about our phones. The clock is always right. You know, think about it. You know, some people are calling this mundane computing. It doesn't have to sort of transform the thing into a whole, you know, incredible feat of technology. How can I make it just a little bit better? Because the investment is so small. Can it cost so little to do things like this? How can I make it just a little bit better at being a microwave instead of turning it into a full-blown browser? Because if you make everything smart, that means you have to learn a whole new operating system every time. You know what? I've already got too many operating systems in my life. And every time I encounter a new one, I have to figure out how it's different from the other things. I have to learn a whole new thing over and over again. And that sucks, right? So how do I get from here to a much more zen-like sort of state of mind with these things? Well, that brings us to sort of to our next stop. Part of maintaining sanity in this world of ever-growing platforms and devices and operating systems is limiting the number of smart interfaces that we have to deal with. If we have a handful of smart devices that control all the dumb devices in our lives, that starts to become manageable and, frankly, more personal. So I want to go on our next stop and talk about remote control. Drive everything, for example, with my phone or my tablet. Apple's AirPlay lets you do that too, although you see it far more rarely. Here's one example. It's a game called Metal Storm Wingman that uses the iPad to fly your plane on the TV. So this is beyond mirroring. Obviously, right? This is a generic device, the iPad, acting like a purpose-built controller, or remote in this case, right? It's working with a dumb device, the TV. Now, of course, this is using Apple's proprietary system with Apple TV, and some of the other big players here, Samsung, Microsoft, they aren't super happy about that. Google, trying to sort of come up with what's our alternative. We saw Google come out with Chromecast this summer, which is this little thing that you plug into your TV that sort of gives it just enough brains to be able to talk to the web and to your phone or tablet. So you can essentially say, hey, TV, I'm watching this video here. Why don't you start downloading it from the web? It sort of seems like mirroring, but it's actually saying, go grab it from the web. So it's really a remote control model. So that's kind of where we're at right now. Gosh, I haven't even left the solar system yet, right? And we're supposed to be embarking on this long journey into the future. This encapsulates, though, what we're seeing right now. What sort of the cutting edge ways that we're pushing mobile technology and changing the way that interaction design works. But let's push that and go a little further out. Here's where things get interesting. An important element of near future, and when I'm saying near future, I mean like next year, like start working on it now, is this idea of sort of more ambiguous control. So I've been talking about smart devices controlling dumb devices. But what I really want to sort of start seeing more of, and that we already have this within our grasp, is shared control among devices, where we have the primary interface shifting from one device to another, depending on our context, depending on where we are. And we already know this concept from the good old-fashioned car phone, right? So say you're driving down the road, and you've got your phone paired with your car by Bluetooth or whatever. You get a call. You answer the call. But you don't answer your phone, you answer your car, right? The car rings, and then you're talking to your car. The point of interface is the car's dashboard and the controls that you might have on your steering wheel. But then when you park your car, you get out, you just keep on talking. The interface follows you. This is this piece of magic that we've already become accustomed to, but it is sophisticated because it has just sort of said, you know what, I'm just going to follow you. And it's moved the point of control from the car into this handheld device that I can just continue without thinking about it. And this is what I call a migrating interface. The car had control over the call, even though it's coming through the phone itself, and then you had this invisible shift of control from one device to another, smart enough just to follow me. Right? Now, there's surprisingly few experiments along these lines in the devices we carry now, but there are a few of these, what I would call social hardware interfaces, like this Scrabble game that came out shortly after the iPad did. Here we have two iPhones sharing control over the single game on the iPad. So we're just flipping tiles from the phone onto the iPad, and it's just sort of happening seamlessly at the appropriate point in the game, right? And there you have it, the world's most expensive board game, right? But that's what you're starting to see, is sort of like just shared control. What's the most appropriate, convenient, most effortless way for me to do what I want to do, and to move not only content, but behavior from one of these devices to another. But frankly, I think the most interesting stuff is yet to come, but it really is about this idea of devices talking to each other, so that as we have this proliferation of gadgets in our life, how can we sort of make content and behavior go seamlessly from them? So here's one sort of, here's one sort of example of that. Corning is a company that makes glass. And for most of their life, they were making things like casserole dishes, measuring cups, household glass. But then they invented this thing called Gorilla Glass, which is the hard glass that's on most of your phones and tablets. And then they were like, wow, screens everywhere? Yes, sign us up. We want that. They created this concept video called A Day Made of Glass. They wish. They'd love to see that. I'm not usually a huge fan of concept videos. They often kind of are a little too convenient. They gloss over technical challenges, financial challenges. What made this one interesting is that after they made it, they went back and recut another version and put in some narration that explained how much of this stuff was actually possible. What was here now, what was sort of still science fiction, what's affordable now, what's expensive. So I want to sort of start by looking at this girl who's using her tablet in her bedroom.
Now, I'm not sure if you noticed, but this closet door is actually a display driven by Amy's tablet. All the intelligence that you see on this display, all these apps, They're all residing and running on Amy's tablet. This display spans the entire door. It has its own small footprint operating system and is smart enough to be aware of Amy's device. And based upon proximity and other rules, it knows what to display and in what format. To make this part of Amy's day a reality, Corning is helping to deliver large-scale, edge-to-edge displays. Corning looks to partners for operating systems and apps that seamlessly scale and transfer between tablets and larger displays.
Oh, is that all, creepy British guy hanging out in little girls' bedrooms? All we need now is the operating systems and the apps that seamlessly scale from tiny to gigantic, right? This is obviously a tall order. This is something that we're starting to work with as designers and developers with things like responsive design. We're seeing Microsoft wrestle with it, really wrestle with it, in Windows 8. It's sort of something that can handle any input and any output. It's a real challenge that we're going to have to deal with. So the software side of this, and our side of it as designers, these are some real challenges to solve. But from the technology, from the hardware standpoint, these big displays that have just enough smarts to be able to provide their own interface but accept software commands from another operating system, another device, that is here, and that is affordable. And so the thing that's interesting is I can take my phone or my tablet with all of the apps and personal information and just take it wherever I need to. And oh, here I am. Now it's just showing up on my screen. It's this idea of a smart device controlling the dumb devices, screens, surfaces, interfaces that I might encounter throughout the day. But that means that we have to start thinking about how do we translate our products, our services, our features in a whole variety of different displays or contexts. And I would say that Corning, you know, their vision says that this could be just about anywhere.
This is Sarah, Amy's sister. Her tablet is just like Amy's. It's her primary computing device, too. Uh-oh, this looks like mischief. This dashboard is made from formed, thin, durable glass. It feels better than plastic, and it looks better, too. It's also a display, which means it can take on the appearance of pretty much anything. Of course, in driving mode, its function is to display critical and ancillary driving information.
All right, so you know we were talking about the tricorder before, and now we're getting into holodeck territory here, right? Where any surface can take on any form driven by the one smart device that we carry with us all the time. This is expensive. You know, they got this stuff in labs, but it's difficult to manufacture, and it costs a lot. It's going to be a little while before we see stuff like this. But against that idea of a single smart device, or a handful of smart devices that talk to the dumb devices and sort of take control, follow us around. How long before we get this? Well, this guy would tell you 20 years. Not 20 years from now, but 20 years from when the thing was invented in a lab. This is a gentleman named Bill Buxton, a friend of mine, and he's like somebody who is an impressively smart guy about interface design, technology, computers. He's at Microsoft Research now. It was his team in the early 80s that invented the capacitive touchscreen, that runs almost all of the consumer touchscreen devices now. He applied Fitt's law to sort of software design, lots of different things. One of his ideas, though, is that it takes 20 years from the moment that something is conceived in a lab to the time when it is ready to go into the mainstream. And not everything does, right? But in general, any good idea will take a 20-year gestation period to go from laboratory to be a hit, which means that anything that's going to be a hit in 5 years has been in the labs for 15. It's already here. Right? We have these building blocks to look around and play with, and some of them are in labs, but frankly, a lot of them are already in our pockets and handbags or in our living rooms in the form of a Kinect, for example, that we're already able to start working with and playing with. And what that means is, you know, we're talking about devices talking to each other by using these sensors, is that we have this really exciting opportunity to design the gaps between devices. And there is real magic in the gaps between devices. We focus all the time on individual interfaces, right? What can we do with this one gadget? often the desktop computer. We're starting to get our heads around this idea of people having a family of devices and having to design experiences that follow you across devices. But what about between them? As more and more gadgets enter our lives, the opportunity is not only about those lonely, siloed experiences, but about designing interfaces across all of them. How can we mix and match sensors to do that? Because we often think not only about individual devices, but individual sensors. This is for mouse. This is for touch. This is for speech. This is for natural gesture. The exciting opportunity is to combine all of them. Because right now, devices are learning how to, we have the technology to understand touch and speech and vision and natural gesture and facial recognition. All of the ways that we communicate as human beings, the machines are learning to do. The technology piece of that is nearly there. It's not totally mature yet for speech or for natural gesture. It's pretty good, but you don't want to run a nuclear power plant with it yet, right? But you can see it's just about to be mature. How do we combine those in interesting ways? It's the combinations, I think, that are really interesting. I think speech and natural gesture together are especially exciting. Because you know, you've got to sort of talk to the computer to let it know that you're waving at it. Wave at it to let it know that you're talking to it. And you know what you get when you combine speech and gesture?
Curriculum rictus empro. Expecto patronum!
Expecto patronum, friends. You get spells. That's like, that is magic. I mean, you know, we talk about, oh, create magical experiences. We are talking about making spells now, right? Where I can just sort of say something and make a gesture, and something happens over there or at a distance, manipulating information, and as we've seen, actual objects, manipulating cows, for crying out loud, with a spell, right? And I'm serious about this. Here's an example. This is my friend Aral Balkan. He looks a little tired here because he's just finished an overnight hackathon. Who's done a hack day before hackathon? A few of you, all right. This can be exhausting work. You're up all night, you've got an idea, you're coding something together. He's done it right, though. You see these wine bottles here? Yeah, and he's on a yacht at Cannes. And so, I mean, he does hackathons the right way. But anyway, he brought to this hackathon a Kinect, a phone, a Mac, and a projector. And this is the hack that he put together.
So you're sitting at home on your sofa, watching television, and something interesting comes on, and you want to share it, say, tweet it. So I walk up to my TV, and I just kind of wave at it so it knows I'm there. And then when something interesting comes up, I can just grab it, and boom,
what?
Put it over there. I grab, and boom, I put it over there. So I'm just holding it in my hand, and I'm putting it on my phone. And that's my hack.
Wow, right? Talk about direct to action, mind to thought, the stuff that Karen was talking about. Something that's totally natural. I just want that. Yeah, put it in here. And I say, you know, we already have the building blocks for this. He did this drunk on a boat overnight. Yeah, right? The pieces are already here. In our handbags, our pockets, our living room, we've already got the stuff to do it. This seems complicated, but really all he had to do was teach the Kinect to recognize this gesture, screenshot, and then, you know, you can walk around like you've got it in your hand, whatever. And then the touch says release it to the phone. In fact, the phone probably already has it, but it's by touching it, I show it. You know, it's like, it's not complicated, but it's the combination of the sensors across devices that make it seem like I am a wizard now. I have moved, I have conjured the content from here to here. And that's the opportunity that we have to create designs for. A lot of people are thinking about how do we move content from one device to another with this kind of same simplicity. Some design students in California a couple years ago put together these paper prototypes, sort of a thought experiment. How might this work with a bunch of, in this case, touch screens of all kinds of different sizes? How do we move content between them? Sort of thought you might have a little fun looking at this. Oh yeah, just shake it out. Rub it back right in there, you know? So you have this idea of creating these sort of physical interactions between the two that borrow from these experiences that we already know from real life. What if we could just sort of mix content and then shake it right into one thing? Well, that seems cute, but a little hard to do, right? We surely don't have interfaces like that now, right? Except we do. They come in the form of toys. You guys, toys are great at experimenting with these new kinds of interactions because they are all about play. And I think about, wow, we've got these technologies. How can we create playful interactions with them? Play with more toys. That's your homework. And video games. Play video games, too. Really forward-looking at thinking about these new kinds of interactions. Siftio cubes are little cubes that can recognize each other, know when they're nearby, interact with each other just through their proximity. They work by connecting by Bluetooth to a computer or to a Wi-Fi hub, sort of transmits the information to them, and then boom, they've got the software, they know about where they are. So they can know when they're touching each other, when they're close to each other. They have accelerometers so you can tip content or gameplay from one into another. Gets even better when you add more cubes. They love when you buy more cubes. More cubes obviously make these sort of word games a little bit more interesting. But so here we have this complete little ecosystem that's made just for games. And the cubes just sort of download the information when they need it. But look how social these little cubes are, right? They interact with each other with all kinds of new combinations of interaction, right? I have this really expensive phone and this really expensive laptop. And when I put this next to that, nothing, right? They just ignore each other. It's rude, right? We should be doing better. You know, if who had a Palm Pilot back in the day? Yeah, right? Remember how easy it was to like beam a contact to somebody? Somehow we lost that. It's really hard to share content with the same person with the person in the same room. Easy to do it to someone across the planet, but hard to do it in the same room. How can we start thinking about some of these interactions? Well, we're starting to see some of it with some of the new fitness tracking devices here, where it's got to be dead easy. You know, get rid of that hassle factor, as Karen called it. It's got to be dead easy to transfer the content from that little device into my phone. The Misfit Shine, called Shine, it's from this company called Misfit, has this little interaction where when you're ready to sync, you know, your number of steps, your points for the day, you just put it on the screen, right? And it's like, ooh, I've got it. It's like, and it looks like, it seems like it's soaking the information up right through the screen. It activates, it lights up, it pulses, and then boom, it's got it. It's actually a clever bit of misdirection. It's doing it by Bluetooth, but because of this aluminum shell, the range is incredibly small, so they got to get it right close to the phone. And to encourage it, they created this interaction that says, you know what, put it here. Detects the touch, and it creates this experience, like it's soaking it up through the phone. So this little clever illusion actually adds some charm and really almost, again, sort of magic to this. All right, so those are migrating interfaces. Our next stop here, so-called passive interfaces. And what I mean by this is devices that just do their work on our behalf, talk to one another, without even needing us to intervene, right? If devices are already smart enough to talk to each other, to share control, then they can start doing some of that stuff on their own, where we're incidental to their behavior. We're just the legs that bring them into proximity, right? So you may have heard of this already, right? This is the Nest thermostat. And it's a thermostat. It's, you know, it just manages the temperature in your home. But it's got proximity sensors to know when you're home, a humidity sensor, temperature, of course. It's got Wi-Fi and internet connections so that it can know what the weather is outside. And then, of course, you can control it either by an app or a web browser from anywhere in the world. It's a thermostat, right? And yet it's packed with all these sensors that let it do things on our behalf to learn. When I adjust the temperature, it says, oh, you are adjusting the temperature an awful lot at this time of day. I'll just do that for you from now on. Just these learned behaviors. This is the brace. This bracelet is the Fitbit Flex. It's like the Nike Fuel Bone or Jawbone Up. It's a wristband that you wear to track your physical activity. It tracks your steps, your sleep, whatever. And it talks to your phone or your computer whenever it comes into contact. It syncs when it can, communicates when it can, using Bluetooth to do this. And from there, the information is available on any device that you care to see it on. So it's a relatively dumb computer. This dumb sensor the dumb display, just a few LED lights, but critically it talks on its own to the machines around it. Sort of starting to see more and more of these kinds of dumb devices that purpose-built but can talk to the smart devices in our lives. This is sort of a thing where we need to change the way that we think about the path of technology. We tend to think that we're always going to get ever more sophisticated devices, more powerful, bigger screens. That is part of our future, right? But at the same time, we're also going to diverge and start getting more dumb devices. These little dumb sensors that have specific jobs, but they don't necessarily have to have their own interfaces. Possibly without screens at all. Yeah, here's a credit card that has a keyboard and a little LED screen that you can enter things out. These things are in test markets from Visa and MasterCard in France and Singapore. And speaking of little displays, we're hearing a lot about these things, right? Smart watches. We'll see if these things pan out. I think we're doing it the wrong way right now. But it's still sort of like, how do you put information that's useful with you all the time, places that even phones can't go on these small screens? How's your website look on this, right? How does it sound by speech? Hopefully you've already been worried about that with accessibility issues, thinking about how your website sounds. But as speech comes on as a first-class input-output mechanism, that's something we're all going to have to deal with. Because we've been focusing on getting our information into rectangles of different sizes, which has been pretty useful. But then, whoa, something like this comes along. It's like, wow, Google Glass, whoa, man, I don't know. How are we going to get that stuff into there? I mean, what's interesting is the watches and Google Glass, for the moment, are windows into our phone. This is part of that vision I was talking about. Sort of relatively dumb interfaces that show our information in ways and contexts that are convenient in the moment, right? But that are powered by our phone. But right now, we're badly equipped to deal with this scenario of content in all kinds of different ways. And it's not so much a technology or a design issue to begin with. At root, it's a content problem. You know, we have to start with our content. Your API is the application. I know I'm talking to designers, and designers are like, oh, that's not my problem. Developers have to worry about the API. And I would say it is your problem. We have to push our design talents down the stack and into the API, because that determines the ingredients that we have for our interfaces. We have to participate in thinking about how do we structure content, define it, chop it up into little bits, the kind of stuff that Ilana was telling us about earlier today, to have really great structured content so that any device can reach out and say, hey, I need these bits to be able to sort of organize the information in a contextually appropriate way on this device, including devices we haven't even imagined yet, because, man, they seem to come on fast. So if we want to, we can't know the future, so we can't be future-proof, but we can at least be future-friendly by planning APIs and structured content that can go to any of these kinds of devices and be exchanged between these devices. And that's creative control in an uncertain world. It also means it'll make our own job a little bit easier, because we won't have to create a new API every time. All right, I'm just going to close with one more stop, and then I'll wrap this up. Our final stop on our journey lands us here, in the cloud, but not the cloud that we see on all the airport signs and the advertisements. It's a cloud of social devices, this constellation of gadgets in our life, both smart and dumb, talking to one another. If you take all these trends that I've mentioned, sensors, mirroring, remote control, migrating control, and passive interfaces, and you have a set of truly social devices that are in our face when we need them, and out of the way when we don't. And that means that we're doing a lot more than just building interfaces, about building applications. Those are just the container. But friends, that's what we seem to focus on all the time, and it makes sense. That's our job. We're builders. We design this thing. But these things get thrown out after a year or two, right? The websites that we built just 2 years ago, throw it out, start it over. Presentation deprecates. Native apps. Anybody here work on iPhone apps? It's like, whoa, all right, I guess we got to start over. iOS 7's here. Presentation deprecates, right? But the thing that's consistent is the content and the service. We are building services. And that's what we need to sort of start thinking about at the outset. What are the problems that we want to help people solve? How do we organize our content and information in useful ways, so we'll be able to go to this whole rich vein of devices instead of focusing on just the one gadget or container. So what I've tried to do here is to pull all together these themes. And this is imperfect, right? Making these connections is hard. Steve Jobs said that you can't connect the dots looking back, looking forward. You can only connect them looking backward, right? Still, this stuff is already here. It's already in labs, as Bill Buxton tells us with his 20-year theory. This stuff's just waiting for us to use it, as the ingredients. But critically, it's also already here, again, in our pockets, in our handbags, in our living rooms. Stuff is already widespread, building blocks that we haven't even started to tap yet, but that are ready for us to start playing with, to be ready for this really rich, again, cloud of social devices that we're seeing. So we started here, and this is where we are now. How do we in the now prepare for this future that I've laid out? Well, first of all, push sensors. You know, these are the things that are going to let us push our interface and our interaction off the screen and usefully into the environment around us in between devices, right? Which means that we have to think social, and for once, I'm not talking about Facebook or Twitter. I'm talking about social devices. How do we make one device social with another? How can we create interactions that make that exchange of information seamless? Think about your ecosystem. You know, again, it's not about individual applications, it's how ready is your ecosystem to accept new devices and new platforms and new interfaces, new screen sizes, or devices without a screen at all. Work on your content, structured content, great APIs. That means we're all cloud developers. You know, that means that we have to start syncing all this information in the cloud. We argue about native apps versus web apps, but friends, our customers don't care. It's an implementation detail to them. It's important to us as the people who have to build and maintain these. But frankly, it all syncs in the cloud, content and behavior, to be able to have this exchange that we're talking about. I described this in detail, that the API is the application. And focus on new input methods. It's not just about mouse or touch. It's about speech and natural gesture, camera vision, facial recognition. Push those sensors. Because the future is already here. We've got all the pieces for extraordinary experiences that we've only begun to think about designing for. The technology part is solved. The design part is what's ahead of us. You guys, we have the coolest jobs in the world at one of the most exciting times in the history of technology and possibly in the history of culture. And I would say that that is a great opportunity to go out and make something amazing. Thanks so much. Thank you.